I normally keep the first slide as my introduction because, but that's a habit. So you've already gone through what? How do I change? So, yes, you've just heard that the conferences are loaded with metabolic diseases, and gastroenterology finds a smaller section in there. But I think we must believe in the old Ayurvedic wisdom that all the diseases of the body arise from the. So I think gastroenterology is a very special place, and I keep talking about another issue is that things like diabetes originate from the liver. So that is another issue. So today I'm talking about a very clinical issue, a chronic diarrhea, which is seen by one and all. And I think we need to have a very clear concepts about it. So let me start with the definitions. Acute diarrhea, less than 2 weeks. Persistent diarrhea, 2 to 4 weeks. And a chronic diarrhea is defined as those diarrhea which persist for more than 4 weeks. So what are the common causes and how common is it? Well, at any given time, it may be affecting about 1 to 5% of the population. And the common causes, certainly in clinical practice, we see a lot of functional diarrhea, irritable bowel syndrome of diarrhea type. And then there are a variety of other causes, the celiac disease, lactose intolerance, which is very common in our country, the metabolic causes, inflammatory bowel disease, tuberculosis, and conditions like small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. But I think the most important thing in evaluation of a patient with chronic diarrhea is a good history. And a history of medication is very important because often you find that it is the medication causing the diarrhea, and you just stop the medication, the diarrhea improves. And there are other issues, and we'll come to that gradually. So, broadly speaking, when you have a patient in your clinic with diarrhea, you try and decide what type of diarrhea the patient has. And if the patient describes a diarrhea which is oily in type, it is loose, it is frothy, etc., you know that he's talking about malabsorption. And when you're talking about malabsorption, you immediately think of it is either the small intestine or the pancreas. Chronic inflammatory diarrheas and inflammatory bowel disease and tuberculosis, etc., are common causes. So they are usually the ones who present more with a large bowel type of diarrhea, with feeling of incomplete defecation. Presence of blood, mucus, etc. is a very important feature there. And then you have those patients with chronic watery diarrhea who may have secretory diarrhea, osmotic diarrhea, drug-induced diarrhea. Infectious diarrhea remains an important entity in our context. And never forget, and this happens not uncommonly in a gastroenterology clinic, that you look at all the aspects of the diarrhea, but forget that thyrotoxicosis and diabetes are themselves very common causes of chronic diarrhea. So I think the first thing one has to decide when you have a patient with diarrhea, is the diarrhea coming from the small intestine? Is it the large intestine? Or is it pancreatic? So these are the areas through which you get the chronic diarrhea. So the diagnostic approach is very simple. Just try to answer the following question. Is it a functional diarrhea or an organic type of diarrhea? Is it a small bowel diarrhea or a large bowel diarrhea? Is the diarrhea associated with malabsorption, in which case there will be specific features, and we'll come to that. Diarrhea associated with abdominal pain or no? Associated with bleeding? Are there features of inflammation? So all these are questions which need to be answered. So let me start with the first one. Is the diarrhea functional or organic? Now, classically, if you have a patient, let's say, presenting with a diarrhea for the last 3 years, and there are no constitutional symptoms, there is no weight loss, the appetite is normal, and interestingly, all the diarrhea is happening during the daytime. There is no nocturnal diarrhea. And there are features of gastrocolic reflex, which means every time I eat, I have to go to the toilet. So there is an exaggerated gastrocolic reflex. and the patient has anxiety symptoms. So these are classical or functional type of diarrhea. There is nothing to suggest that the patient has an organic disease whereby he must have developed other features by now, including constitutional features, weight loss, etc. On the other hand, organic cause will have a shorter history. So you don't have patients with tuberculosis or ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease, you know, staying like that for years on. They usually present to you within weeks or months. And they have marked constitutional symptoms. There may be weight loss. There may be a decrease in appetite. And the diarrhea is also present during the night. So that is a very important distinction. Nocturnal diarrhea is usually suggestive of organic disease. There is no exaggeration of gastrocolic reflex, but tenesmus may be there. And anxiety symptoms are less common, but you can have a mix of the two as well. So these are the broad features differentiating. What are the risk factors? Where should we be cautious that we do further investigations if there is a family history, if there is a history of previous surgery, previous pancreatic disease, history of thyroid disease, diabetes, history of alcohol, and as I said, always take a meticulous history regarding the medication. And also remember that antibiotic associated diarrhea, the patient may have had his antibiotics 2 or 3 weeks ago and yet presented with diarrhea which persisted after that. So that is also another important issue. So now I come to the next question. Is it a small bowel diarrhea or a large bowel diarrhea? Now, small bowel diarrheas, the number of stools are lesser, but the volume is larger. So large, bulky stools, which may be frothy or greasy if there is malabsorption. There is no blood, no mucus, no pus, and no tenesmus. So these are features of small bowel diarrhea. On the other hand, large bowel diarrhea, patients keep on passing small amount of stools, but very frequently. And this usually happens in patients with proctitis, in ulcerative colitis, let's say. So small volume stools, frequently passed, associated with blood, mucus, pus, and there is a history of tenesmus. So it is a clear distinction. I think if you take a history properly, you can understand whether it is small bowel or large bowel diarrhea. And if you have a patient with small bowel diarrhea, you have to decide two things. Whether there is malabsorption or is it a small bowel diarrhea without malabsorption. So malabsorption, you will have a clear history of the oily stools, frothy stools, bulky stools. Anemia may be present and there will be features of nutritional deficiencies. And you have to immediately think of conditions like celiac disease, tropical sprue, parasitic infections, etc. But one entity I would like to point out specifically is don't forget small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, which is very common in diabetics. Now, these are the features of malabsorption. If there is no malabsorption, then usually it is a secretory type of diarrhea, large volume diarrhea. And the distinction between secretory diarrhea and osmotic diarrhea is very simple. Osmotic diarrhea, if you ask the patient to stop eating, the diarrhea stops. On the other hand, in a secretory diarrhea, even if the patient stops eating, the diarrhea continues. So large bowel diarrhea, again, you have to make two distinctions, functional diarrhea, which is the commonest one, irritable bowel syndrome of diarrhea type or functional diarrhea. But organic diarrheas must always be remembered, and it is easier to diagnose if there is presence of blood, mucus, etc., where you think of inflammatory bowel disease, tuberculosis, solitary rectal ulcer syndrome, tumors, etc. But there will be a category of patients, and again, I say you all are primarily physicians, that in those who have no blood, have got large bowel diarrhea, always remember this entity called microscopic colitis, which I think is underdiagnosed. And talk about drugs as well. Well, the next question was painful or painless diarrhea. And painless diarrhea in all the malabsorptive conditions, but painful diarrhea in all the inflammatory type of conditions. So tuberculosis, Crohn's disease, Whipple's disease, etc. And if the patient has got inflammatory type of diarrhea, there might be presence of fever, constitutional symptoms, joint symptoms, etc. So if you have a patient where you've identified has got a chronic inflammatory diarrhea, you must try and differentiate, is it due to inflammatory bowel disease? Is it due to infection, particularly tuberculosis in India? Pseudomembranous colitis, ischemia, radiation, and neoplasia. And on the other hand, remember, there can be sometimes chronic infective type of diarrhea, and don't forget pseudomembranous colitis, the C. difficile, and tests for that are available in most places now. In patients, particularly those who are immunosuppressed, cytomegalovirus, entamoeba histolytica, these days not very common. Many a times previously, all these patients with ulcerative colitis were called amoebic colitis. But nowadays, we can make a very simple, clear distinction. Mycobacterium tuberculosis remains an important cause. And in this slide, I've just pointed out some of the drugs, and you all know about it. But I think the important thing is to take a history. And many a times, you find that patients using olmesartan, which is a very common drug used in clinical practice now, they will have diarrhea. So olmesartan, etc., must be remembered. And I will not go into each and every drug because I think you know it already. And if you do not know, for our youngsters, the graduate and the postgraduates, I would suggest that you always look up and check the Google or your book for all the different drugs which can cause. So when you are evaluating now a chronic diarrhea, the history should also include what is the relationship to food. And every time the patient eats and has to go to the toilet but has no other constitutional features, always think of irritable bowel syndrome. As I said, if the diarrhea stops with fasting, think of osmotic diarrhea. If it occurs in spite of fasting and even during sleep, it is secretory type of diarrhea. And I think we talk about measurement of stool electrolytes, calculate the osmolality. Hardly anybody does that, except in a research setting. So I think we have to hear a condition where just by clinical acumen, history taking, physical examination, you can make a very simple diagnosis. Abdominal pain and diarrhea. If the pain is in the left lower quadrant in particular, and in Indian sometimes even in the upper abdomen, IBS must be considered. On the other hand, Crohn's disease is usually pain presentation which is periumbilical or in the right lower quadrant because it is ileocecal disease is more common. And then you have the gastrinomas, peptic ulcers, which are responsible for the upper abdominal pain, and clearly they would have epigastric pain. And for those with malabsorption, you must look for, you know, nutritional deficiency features. And on the right-hand side, I've shown a number of things, neuropathy, glossitis, angular stomatitis, you know, because of nutritional deficiencies. So this is what, when you're doing a clinical examination, you must look for. So I will just come to the primary assessment of these patients. Always do some basic investigation. CBC, C-reactive protein, to look for any evidence of inflammation. Thyroid function and blood sugar, I think, should always be done. And since celiac serology, we are doing very commonly now. It is common even in southern part of India, and north it is very common. Stool examination has always been contentious. Are we doing the stool examinations properly? And in most centers, it is not being done properly, but always in clinical, depending on the clinical scenario, try to look for the C. difficile, ovases, parasites. And these days we have a very interesting and a very non-invasive fecal calprotectin test, where if you cannot differentiate between inflammatory bowel and irritable bowel, you can just do the fecal calprotectin level. If it is low, it favors irritable bowel syndrome. If it is high, it shows that there is inflammation or ulceration in the gut, and therefore the patient requires further investigation. And if the cancers or inflammation are suspected, then we as gastroenterologists go on with colonoscopies, ileoscopies, biopsy, etc. Celiac disease, simple is upper GI endoscopy and biopsy, but always do the TTG, which is a screening test, anti-TTG IgA. And if you are suspecting disease of the small bowel, I think wherever possible, I would say, because barium meal follow throughs are not good at all. And you now have CT or MR enterography in most places. So go for CT enterography or MR enterography, and you can do a capsule endoscopy. Malabsorption, again, if you suspect a pancreatic problem, then you can go for CT MRI for structural definition of the pancreas and do a test which is very commonly available now, fecal elastase. And if it is low, then certainly it points towards malabsorption. And then if you suspect the other variety of conditions, then you must do enterography, upper GI, biopsies, etc. And where surgical conditions like diverticulosis, etc. is suspected, MRI or CT will be again useful. So I will just come to just a few common problems. Lactose intolerance must always be recognized. Almost 60% of the Indian population are lactose intolerant. Suspect if milk intake causes bloating, borborygmi, diarrhea. And a simple glucose or lactose challenge test. Ek glass doodh bade wale glass mein pila do. And see if the patient develops symptoms after that. But if you are a science purist, go for the hydrogen breath test. And simple thing is avoid milk intake. So if you made a diagnosis, treatment is always very simple. And this condition I would certainly like to point out because I think it is often missed and underdiagnosed. And it is almost present in 1 to 2% of the population. And many of the patients who we diagnose as irritable bowel syndrome of diarrhea type have actually got bile acid diarrhea. And it is said that 50% of the patients with functional diarrhea have bile acid diarrhea. So just to give a word of caution, always think of this condition. Usually in those who have undergone cholecystectomy or those who have undergone ileal surgery, it can be idiopathic. It is usually a painless osmotic type of diarrhea, non-inflammatory. And the diagnosis, very difficult. CCAT test, the only time I've done it is in when I was in UK. Not easily available. And fecal bile acid, again, is something which can be done, but it requires two-day collection and measurements, which is not easily available everywhere. So if you suspect, just give a therapeutic trial of cholestyramine, which is a bile sequestrant. It will bind the bile and thereby improve the diarrhea. So before, if you're getting frustrated with what is the cause, and if you suspect this condition, give a trial of cholestyramine. There's nothing wrong with it. Microscopic colitis, as I said, is a condition you must be aware of. Painless watery diarrhea, particularly in those who are above 45 years, females more than males, those who are diabetics, taking non-steroidals, those who have rheumatoid arthritis and celiac disease are more susceptible, and the diagnosis is made. And interestingly, when we do the colonoscopy, you don't find any lesion. It is only on the biopsy. So it is important that when we are doing the colonoscopy in a patient with suspected microscopic colitis, we take multiple biopsy from multiple sites in the colon. Pancreatic diarrhea will be relatively easier. It's a steatotic diarrhea, malabsorption associated with chronic pancreatitis. Imaging is important, and fecal elastase test will be useful. Treat with pancreatic supplement. So once you've made the diagnosis, the treatment becomes easy. But this condition, as I said, is a hot favorite of gastroenterologists these days. SIBO, presenting as diarrhea, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. When to suspect? Predominant symptom is diarrhea, milk intolerance is marked, older age, longer duration, marked abdominal bloating and flatulence associated. And remember, patients who's been on years of PPI therapy, they are more likely to have small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. History of response to antibiotics and probiotics will be there. That was a very gastrointestinal type of sound I heard. I will limit my role of imaging. All I want to see is that imaging should be confined to patients where you suspect pancreatic disorders or in patients who are predisposed to bacterial overgrowth, such to locate diverticulas, blind loops, intestinal hypomotility, dilatations, fistulas, tumors. But routine use of barium meal follow-through is discouraged. Always go for MR and CT enterography. And once you've made the diagnosis, I think there is no point in talking about treatment. Celiac disease, you all know, tropical sprue. Again, simple antibiotics, folic acid, tuberculosis, anti-ATT, and Crohn's disease, you all know, pancreatic diarrhea is supplements. So approach to a patient with chronic diarrhea needs a detailed history and a clinical examination. Achieve a specific diagnosis using a minimum number of tests. And I think that is important. Otherwise, you will end up doing all the tests in everyone. Individualize investigations. And if a disease seems more likely, directly proceed to confirm it. Not necessary to do all the tests in everyone. Now, if you have 2 minutes, then I can just show a few history if you have postgraduates in the listeners there. Now, this is, in fact, normally I ask this question, but young boy with 7 years history of diarrhea, 3 to 5 undigested food, there is no blood, no pain, no fever, no joint pain. Examination show low body weight and anemia. And there are features of vitamin deficiency. So clearly we are talking about small bowel malabsorption. Young boy, long history. What is the diagnosis? Well, clearly celiac is the most likely diagnosis. What tests would you do? I think you can just go for anti-TTG antibody and do a duodenal biopsy over there. And if you really, because sometimes giardiasis can mimic, so you can look for stool for parasites as well. This is the next case, 36-year-old male presented with diarrhea, occasional blood for 3 months. Now, blood is present here with a history of right-sided abdominal pain. And I've already said, if you have blood and right-sided abdominal pain, with anorexia, recent fever for 2 weeks, I think immediately you start thinking of inflammatory bowel disease or tuberculosis. And in this particular patient, when we did the colonoscopy, we found a typical cobblestoned pattern, which is suggestive of inflammatory bowel disease, and the biopsy confirmed it. And this is probably the last case. And this I'm showing because this is something which you find in clinical practice physicians in particular. 65-year-old, long-standing diabetes with polyarthropathy, has watery diarrhea with gas and bloating for 6 weeks now. So diabetes, polyarthropathy, so drug intake, we have to think. So what are the differentials we'll think of in this sort of a situation? And you have to think of, first of all, long-standing diabetic, could it be diabetic diarrhea? Or could it be drug related? The patient has been taking probably metformin for a long time, or maybe non-steroidals. Small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, microscopic colitis is something again, because this is a highly high risk group, and pancreatic diarrhea. So these are simple cases I have shown where you don't need to do a huge number of investigations, do a good clinical meticulous history, clinical examination, come to some, you know, narrow down your differentials and do the appropriate tests and come to a diagnosis. Life will be simple in primary health care. Thank you.